Yeah, both, but Phil, yeah, right.
Or you could have a thing, that once they've registered, you could have like a share this on your, you could probably do a share this kind of button, or...
It's good to see the buzz on your own site, so that people can get social proof that, oh, I know them, or look at all the activity.
Right.
Yeah, but the share it, you're gonna get a very small response rate. What I'd wanna do is have it automatic, and then make them opt out or something.
I don't know how you do that, because you've got the, I mean, you've got to log in, you've got to have the credentials to get into your social media account for this to work. Now what you could do is you could have a field in the form that they fill out, like when they register, you could have it so, you know, you do a post, and it'll make like a tweet, for example, and it'll mention that, you know, it'll mention them in the tweet, and then, you know, then they would get it in their Twitter account that you mentioned them. So you could very easily do that.
Yeah, add your Twitter handle, and then it just Twitter recognizes the Twitter.
You can add the Twitter handle, and you can concatenate anything from the field, you can concatenate into the title of the post or the body of the post. So if you put, for example, the handle of their Twitter handle into your post, and then you post it, you know, your post will have their, and then it'll automatically kick over to Twitter, and then so their thing will automatically end up in their handle will automatically end up in your Twitter account. They should be the notification.
Aren't there a bunch of plugins that do this?
Well, there's a plugin for everything.
Yeah, I'm sure there is.
Well, Jetpack has this all, you know, but this is a little bit more advanced, right?
Yeah. This is the, you know, the MailChimp does the same thing basically for your email subscribers, and you can have mailing lists in there. So if you got a big event coming, and this could be really stressful if you don't realize this could happen to you, because it happened to me. So if you upload about, you know, a big mailing list into MailChimp, and you know, some of them might be old emails and things like that, and you know, if they bounce, if there's a high bounce rate, they will shut that list down. So you know, you can have an event coming, and then you know, you set up to do all this, and you load all your you know, whatever mailing list they provide. If you load it up in there, if you have a high bounce rate, they'll shut it down. And like you know, the integration between MailChimp and Gravity Forms, they'll shut that integration down as well. So
MailChimp will.
What's that?
MailChimp.
Yeah, MailChimp will shut that down. And then they'll say, okay, now you have to sign up through our little thing that you put on your site. So that can cause some pretty big headaches if you've got a big event coming. You know, you got events coming, you have a lot of deadlines and stuff. So
have you seen anything that cleanses old email lists?
Just the people from the organization had to go through and verify. I mean, I think it notifies you. You know, you get some notifications.
No.
In MailChimp, it'll tell you which ones bounce.
But you don't know of another service that will actually
do it.
Our service is out there that will do that, but you have to pay for it, from what I've heard.
Yeah.
I haven't.
You can also sign up for one of the like Constant Contact free accounts and see how your first mailing list does.
Yeah.
It's a shitty little
bounce. But is the problem bouncing or people, you know, complaining, what, you know, this is spam?
The old one, it's usually bouncing.
They can tell if it's going to bounce before they send it. So they won't even send it. They can, you know, MailChimp has, before, you know, it preps it, and I think that, you know, it can tell from the, I don't know how it does it, but they can tell which ones are going to bounce before they even send that thing out.
So the penalties are there for probably users complaining, hey, I didn't want that, yeah.
If you get a lot of people opting out or, you know, that sort of thing. So.
And actually, MailChimp is trying to avoid their servers being blocked by their provider.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Which is ultimately what it's about.
And if you're using the free, you know, MailChimp's free up to like 20,000 emails or something, but you know, they're not gonna provide any customer support at that level. And even if you do pay the $9 a month, they're not gonna clean your list up for you. They're just gonna tell you it needs to be cleaned up. So I talked to the folks from Emma, which is like another mail service that has pretty nice, I haven't used it, but I've seen it and it looks like a pretty nice service. And they actually have phone support for, you know, whatever rate that you, I think it's a fairly reasonable price, and they'll pick up the phone and talk to you and help you solve your problems there. MailChimp will give you email support for like $9 a month. And beyond that, I'm not sure. So with a single form, like the user, like they're signing up for your event, for example, with the Gravity Forms, you can integrate the, you know, their password and username. You can actually make them, you can set it up, you can integrate it with your WordPress site, so they'll actually become a user on your site. right? So that's, that can be automated, and then if you have your email integrated with MailChimp, so in one shot you can get all their information. You can also make them user of your website, and you can, you know, you can add their email automatically to your MailChimp mailing list. So that's one of the nice things you can do, save some work there. Because otherwise you have to, what, set up a user account individually, then gather the information, and then use, you know, an individual sign up widget or whatever. All right. So this is just kind of common sense. Prevent a catastrophe. Make a checklist and make sure that you follow that checklist every time. It's good to put this in like a Word doc that can be shared with other people that you're working with. And this is a quote that I actually, from an email that I got from one of the organization leaders, I guess. He said, has anybody actually paid for the event? We're in deep trouble if the system is not processing payments, but it's notifying people that they have registered. So if you don't have your form set up right, you're going to have some payment issues. And so I put some of the things in that. So I made this checklist. You got to integrate your payment gateway when you make a new form. It's really easy to do, but it's really easy to forget. And I mean, you can still have the item in there that takes the credit card stuff. It looks like it'll work, but it doesn't. Let's see, flush your cash. I use GoDaddy. They have this with the managed WordPress. They have a thing where you got to flush your cash. So you make all the updates you want to that form. If you forget to flush the cash, you know, you'll see it on your computer. You see it on every computer in your house. You can see it on your phone. All those. It's kind of weird, you know, that it messes your head a little bit. But nobody outside of your house is going to see this thing. So always whenever you make changes to the data, to the form, make sure you flush the cache, because what will happen is when you change the form, it changes how it talks to the database. So you might have fields in your database that don't even exist anymore. And if they're using a cached version of the web page that serves them the form, it's sending data to, you know, form to database fields that don't exist anymore. And the transactional fails what will happen.
I got a quick question. So how would you flush the cache if you're not using a managed service? Or is that something I can
it's
look
only
up?
When you're using a service that either
because it's crazy.
Either you're using WordPress with total cache or super cache, or you're using WP Engine with a caching system, or GoDaddy with a caching. But if you don't have caching,
but it's not caching.
Then you don't have to worry about it.
So you're not talking about browser caching.
No, you're talking about WordPress caching. No, you're talking about caching at the server level. Which speeds up page loads.
Yeah, but why? I mean, the cache, every time you make a change, even if you're change adding a comma, the cache should automatically be flushed. Otherwise, there's something wrong with your system. I mean, the user shouldn't have to be thinking about this. Or the not the user, the you shouldn't have to be thinking
about it. Yeah, I've never had the problem in the past until recently. I said, all right, the form's up, and you know, I started getting phone calls. This thing's not up like you say it is. Now, I checked it on all my computers at the house. Now, I guess it does something in your router. I think you'd have to reboot your router or something like that. I'm not sure.
It's just that the problem and solution is the hosts are caching stuff at the page level. So they have the last best version of the page. And if you're a developer, even if you hit update, it's not going to dump that cache. You just want to make sure you clear all cache pages from on your server environment. You flushed the cache and you're seeing it on the live site. You know, you dumped your browser cache too, and you just make sure you go through that process of dumping your browser cache, dumping the cache at the server first, dumping your browser cache next, refreshing the page and make sure that you can see, and then you do the transaction yourself and know that it goes through, then you've confirmed that, you know, you've done your QA, right, is what you're saying.
When I learned about this, it happened on the transaction where the president of the association tried to register, and it didn't work. And so I had to go in and figure it out, and you know, I figured this out, but it happened to me, so that's kind of where that. So when the users register, it won't automatically send all the details of the transaction to the person that registered, unless you manually go in. You got to manually go in and set that up. So that's one item on the checklist, because they're going to ask for that if they're wanting to write off the event on their taxes. All right, and this is just common sense, but it'll help you a lot if you just remember to test the form with a small group of people. What's that?
10 minutes.
All right, we'll get close to the end here. So there's probably going to be mistakes when you set this up, and you know, if you assume that it's okay, you'll find out when you send it out to the masters that there's going to be all kinds of things that they'll find in the case. So just, you know, send it to a few people like on the board or the committee or that you're working with. So that's my main checklist right now. I haven't come across any other things. All right. So I talked about concatenating the stuff from the field into your post. I'm going to run through this real quick. So going into the form, what I did is I set up an example form, and I'm hoping to do another bar camp. So being hopeful about that, I made a form for registering for bar camp 2016. This, you know, just some basic information: the phone, name, email, organization name, sponsorship level. Upload the logo. So if you don't, when you're dealing with sponsors, they might give you the money. And you might get money from, like, say, six or seven or a dozen of them. I've seen this happen before. But they don't have all the logos, all the information that you need. And then you're going to have to chase those sponsors down. And they're going to be dealing with, like, marketing departments and stuff like that to get the logo, to get the, and, you know, a lot of times these logos have guidelines and stuff. So they're going to have, like, a whole manual of rules. So what I try to do is, like, I like to capture all one transaction. I like to get the logo and get the guidelines. And then you're not chasing that stuff down afterwards. All right, and so I have in this form, this is like the back end, I have the post title and the post body. And and then I have like a statement about your business right here, right? So if they, you know, you give them the opportunity to say something about their business, hey, we're great, we do this. So they can put that in right there. And actually, this will not be visible on the side of the users. You can set this up to be hidden. I mean, you can set it up so they can see it, but generally what I'm doing here is I hide these. And so here's an example. I filled in the form. And let's see. All right, and so now this right here is the post title, right? So what you do is you can check, okay, create a content template. If you check this button right here, It'll give you the option right here. This is like a field that you can fill in. And this little button right there, if you click on that, it gives you a drop-down menu of all the fields that are in your database from that form that you created. And let's see. Okay, so what that is, you can't see all this. So I copied it out and I added it here. This is the text that's going in here. And the stuff that's in the brackets, that's the name of like the field, right? So whatever they put into the sponsorship level, and you know, whatever they chose, whatever that is, it's gonna plug it in right there into your title. The group name. So the organization, the sponsor's name, it'll plug that right into the title of the post, which is nice, right? When you post it, and then it'll automatically go to Twitter, and you know, you're giving recognition. Then you can put like a you can add other HTML stuff in there, so like you can put hashtag, you know, whatever the name of the event is, and then that will also, you know, be in the title.
Is there a possibility that somebody basically could be hijacking this or you know, sending out links to porn websites or something like that to come back and bite you?
Well, you definitely want to take a look at it. I mean, it's going to be, you know, once it plugs in, you're going to take a look at it before you publish it. It's just going to be text. You know, so
you'll get a note as a organizer, you'll get a notice that, hey, listen, we're going to send this out. You know, crew, you'll get a note.
And obviously, there's always going to be vulnerabilities. Verifone's been around for a long time. It's got a lot of scar tissue, I think. And they've been pretty good about security, I guess. So,
plus, it's something nobody's going to pay, you know, to go to an event to spam somebody with one porn link, right?
Yeah. I mean, and you just wouldn't publish it. I mean, you're going to look at the post already.
That's the thing. So you get that pending thing.
Yeah.
So what I did here is, now this one, now moving on, it's kind of the same thing, but this is the body of the post. And I'm going to show you an example. Once we get through all this, I'll show you what it looks like in the end. So kind of the same thing. This is what it looks like when you're building the form, right? So this is like a big old formula, I guess. But everywhere that I highlight it, all those ones that are highlighted, those are forms, fields in the form. So the information from that form is going to be placed in there from those items. for example, I had one field that said, you know, name without, so this is like the Twitter name without the at symbol. There's a reason for that, but that's a field, right? So it's going to plug in that information right there. And then what you can do is you can make like a link out of that, and then you can also make the text for the link. So once they submit it, this is what it looks like when it shows up in your WordPress posts or whatever. So you can see, you know, everywhere there was a highlighted thing, it, you know, this was a field, it plugged it right in there. So, you know, it's ready to publish pretty much. Everything was in this field, it automatically puts it in there for you. And then, I'll just show how to insert a form into a web page. All right, so this is what it looks like when you publish it. So if I was a sponsor and I filled out this form, this is what the this is what goes in the title, and it, you know, the picture, you can have that automatically go in there. You just kind of set up the reference link for that, and then you can concatenate that, so that'll go in automatically. You might have problems with that. If they put this humongous picture there, that's not going to work. But it is possible. You can like highlight certain parts that you put in there, and then, you know, it feels like I put in like this link that I submitted. You know, I submitted like my Twitter handle, you know, it puts it in there, it makes a link out of it, and it also tells you what it is. You know, behind that you've got the hyperlink that'll take you straight to the Twitter page. You know, you've got the HTTPS /. You know, so it puts all your stuff in there ready to publish.
Can you go back to
that? Oh, this up here I highlighted all the items that were put in from the form.
Would you mind going back to that one slide where you had all the tags in code?
So earlier when I was talking about what I did, and I used this whole thing I just showed you. I used that when I did the BarCamp conference. And so like all these right here, all from here and above, they were all sponsors. And I used that form to get their logo and all that stuff. And then all these down here, these are like community partners, right? So they had a form similar to that. And they submitted the form, the logos, all that stuff. So that went on the t-shirts and all that sort of thing. So we used
2 minutes.
This. What's that?
2 minutes.
2 minutes?
Yeah.
This is my last slide, so.
Okay.
Right. Good job. All right. Woo. Any questions?
Well done.
Okay. You got a minute left? Any questions?
I'm just, did you do the event organizing for this, with this software, or?
For this event?
Yeah.
No, so this newsletter that I do, I publish a newsletter about events, and so like I help promote events like this, and then they let me in free, or, you know, give me a booth, and so we kind of work together. But I didn't actually help with this one. I helped promote it. I was like a sponsor of this event. But
you might want to talk about using Meetup, because even if you have a separate group, Meetup is a great one.
So Meetup is really good, and the sticking point with Meetup is if you use that for your organization, it's really good. A lot of people use it. It's free. But if you build up like a following in that thing, and then you decide, okay, well, now I want to move to something else, all your contacts, they're not coming out of there. Meetup doesn't give you access to any email addresses or any kind of, you know, contact information. So you just got to make sure that down the road that you're not going to want to move to a different platform, because you can go find, you know, if you build up a group of 2,000 followers, now you want to move to WordPress, well, you're not going to do it.
Yeah, Meetup has a cost. Meetup has a cost to it too. I have Meetup groups, and it's a cost. It's like $60 every 3 months for 3 groups,
yeah,
or something like that.
Alrighty.
We have till 10:30. 50 minutes, right?
Yeah,
10:30. Yes, 9:30, 10:30, according to schedule. We've got a break from 10:30 to 11.
No, 11 is the next one, isn't it?
Yeah, it's 10:10. I thought it was a 50-minute session. Is that right?
I think it is. I think it'll give you 10 minutes to change class course.
This is a half-hour break, too. So. Oh, is it a half-hour break right now?
Yeah, so how do you like WP Engine?
I love it.
Appreciate it.
Okay.
Good.
Any,